Serve something like this to a guest at home, you'll definitely wow them. You'll probably blow their socks off.
We are going to toss the arbi, which is a very popular dish in Delhi.
That curry certainly has all the flavor of the prawn.
Hi folks, welcome to another episode of Gourmet On The Road. And in this episode, we're not going to be visiting a restaurant or an eatery like we typically do. But we have been invited to lunch by one of India's top chefs, Chef Abhijit Saha. And I'm also joined by my wife Shri in this episode. Now, Chef Abhijit Saha is widely regarded as one of the country's leading culinary minds, having won numerous accolades and also has represented India on the world stage in many culinary competitions and symposiums. He has also recently launched a book called the Caperberry Cookbook, named after his progressive restaurant. So we're going to catch up with Chef Abhijit Saha, talk about his cookbook, and most importantly, also taste some great food. Now, home-cooked food at one of India's top chef's homes, cooked by him and his family. Now, that's a first on Gourmet On The Road, and I'm looking forward to this. So stick around to this episode till the very end. Hey, Chef, how are you?
Welcome, good to see you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us over. Good to see you, Shruti. I think it's been a while since we caught up.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that we found this opportunity to catch up.
I'm also happy that you made it.
Belated birthday wishes. Yesterday was Chef's birthday. And congratulations also on the Caperberry cookbook. And I can see that book right there.
Thank you.
May I, Chef?
Yes, please.
I know you've been working on this book for a long time.
Yes, that's right.
So I know this cookbook has been in the making for a while. Because I wrote the foreword for this.
Yes.
I think some time ago.
Yes.
When I think you had just finished the first draft of the book.
Yes, that's right.
Right?
That's right.
And, you know, I've seen many cookbooks. You know, this is not just another cookbook. This cookbook is a labor of love.
Yeah.
I think it's taken you the better part of 3 or 4 years.
Yes, that's right. So, the idea behind writing the Caperberry cookbook was to bring to our customers, guests, readers, young chefs, the concept of Caperberry.
Okay.
How it was created, how it was conceptualized, how it was set up, what specials did we do there, the menus, the dishes. It's a complete revelation of the restaurant. So if you go through this book, it'll make a wonderful read, first of all, that how a restaurant in the process is involved, and also goes into the details of basics of cooking, and also the intricate things that we do with the food in Caperberry.
So this is a tell-all cookbook.
It is.
You've not held anything back.
Nothing. Nothing.
So what was the objective behind writing this
book? To share the knowledge. It's okay. To make it an all-inclusive book. As you know, Caperberry is a restaurant that is inspired by modernist Spanish cuisine and European cuisine. My idea is that it should be something that should be very useful for any chef in any part of the world who wants to know about modernist cuisine or modernist European cuisine.
All right.
So basically this is something called as in technical terms known as a book for cooks. So you can be a professional chef to use this book.
That's Ayoli there.
Hi Ayo.
Abhijit and Shruti's baby, who's also decided that she wants to be a part of the
shoot.
So this is a book that traces the journey, right?
Yes.
So it begins with the city, it begins with the state, it talks about your travel, your inspirations, and how all of that finally found its way into that concept initially, which later, of course, became reality in the restaurant called Caperberry. And I think this book basically brings all of that out.
Yes.
So tell me, how relevant is this book, let's say, to a food lover? You know, one who may not really have any aspirations of being a chef,
right?
Or perhaps doesn't have a professional background.
Mm-hmm.
How relevant is this book?
So for me, you know, you will find many such books in the market.
Okay.
And it is not necessary that the recipes that you get in those books are always doable at home.
All right.
So because it is called the Caperberry Cookbook, I have tried to keep the recipes as the way we do it in the restaurant.
Okay.
But this is very, very critical in the sense that you also get to learn beyond your regular food. Mm. So it is a special cookbook for special occasions and for special dishes. So when you want to serve some people great food and you want to learn something special, this is the book that you have to refer to. And I believe that 50% of the recipes can be easily done at home.
All right.
Today, most of these ingredients are available in the market, may not be in the regular markets, but in specialized shops that specialize in lots of imported ingredients and seasonal ingredients. So I have included also farms from where we buy these vegetables and different fruits from, which are all in and around Bangalore. And I have also included something which is very important with this kind of food, which is the wine. And the idea was to bring in the aspect of wine, demystify wines also with the food that we serve. Many people would enjoy this kind of a recipe with a bottle of wine. All and it doesn't have to be from Spain. It can be also from India, in Bangalore, in and around Karnataka, where we make some great wines.
All right. So basically, this is a cookbook that has recipes that are designed to impress. This is not your everyday sort of a cookbook. This cookbook needs to be deployed when you want to make that special meal, that special lunch, that special dinner to impress someone. That's what the Caperberry Cookbook is about.
Yeah.
And as Abhijit has just mentioned, the recipes are completely doable.
Yes.
So Abhijit, as they say, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So
yes,
when you say these recipes are doable, can we take a look at something being
yes,
put
we
together?
Will definitely cook something. It's a combination of a soup, cold soup,
okay,
with some burrata with it. And you will see that the ingredients are very simple and very easy to make. It doesn't require any cooking. It's
all
a
right.
cold dish.
Oh, fantastic. So let's look at that.
Gazpacho.
Gazpacho and burrata.
Yeah. The recipe that we are making is basically gazpacho, which has already been made here. Chilled tomato soup.
Okay. And is this part of the book?
It is a part of the book.
Okay.
The gazpacho is a part of the book. So this is the image.
Ah, so is this what we are going to be putting
that's
together?
Right. That's right. That's right.
It certainly looks lovely.
Yeah.
And quite appealing.
Yeah.
So tell me, chef, when you have things like the olive powder, black olive powder, this is something that you don't get in stores.
Yes.
So
no. The recipe is there.
All
we
right.
have a section called basic recipes.
Okay.
In which all such interesting things which compose a dish, which we use in composing a dish and making it more exciting,
are all there. So basically people can just pick up that book and find the recipe to each and every element.
Each and every element that is.
Of course, this is a sort of recipe that does take some effort in putting together, right?
Yes.
So like you said, it's a recipe that's designed for that special meal.
Meal, yes.
So it's not a typical soup or salad. This is a recipe that's designed to impress.
Simplicity is still a part of the book.
Yes.
Elegance and simplicity. We don't want recipes to be very, very cumbersome.
Okay.
So as you can see, I will put some of the basil. Pesto in the center. Pesto is a very Italian kind of a sauce which has got basil.
All right.
It's got pine nuts. It's got garlic. And it's got Parmesan cheese. And extra virgin olive oil. Then we will take the burrata.
And this is a burrata that comes locally.
Locally. Then we put some watermelon. Put three of them.
Okay.
And now we will pour the gazpacho.
Oh, that looks lovely. So chef, is the gazpacho and burrata ready?
Yeah, if you want to serve it like this, it's good enough.
Okay.
But you know, you want to make it special.
You want to glam it up.
Yes. So we will add some black olive powder. You see, the color will come through. Then we have the garlic crumbs.
Rockets
can
be gone in.
The red chard. And then we have some microgreens here. And then we will add some extra virgin olive oil. Edible flowers, if you want to make it even more special. It is embellishing the dish further.
Serve something like this to a guest at home, You'll definitely wow them. You'll probably blow their socks off. This looks appealing. I think we should
taste it.
Get started. I'm going to take that gazpacho.
Bon appetit. Yeah.
So it's got that sweet acidity.
Yes. Yes.
It's not puckeringly sour. Yeah. It's got that sweet, smooth acidity.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to taste the gazpacho next and also steal a bit of the pesto that's sitting beneath the burrata. Now you get a bit of that herbaceous, peppery hit.
Yes,
of that right. Pesto.
Pesto, yes, that's right.
So basically, this dish is a combination of flavors.
Yes.
You taste the fruity sweetness of the watermelon.
Yeah, so there's the crunch, then there's the gazpacho, which is liquidy, creamy, and the pesto, which is peppery.
That's
a little
right.
bit nutty.
And I think what will be the piece de resistance of this
yes.
dish is that burrata. We'll get some of the burrata with that gazpacho and the pesto. That burrata just unburdens itself of all that dairy richness. Oh, I love that. So you're tasting the mellow, creamy goodness of that burrata, that molten cheese.
Yes.
And then the sweet acidity of that gazpacho with the nuttiness of the pesto. Oh, this is a delicious combination. So when you put it together, it looks simple. It looks
yes.
too simple, in fact.
Yes.
But when you look at that dish, it definitely stuns you. And then when you taste it, it's a flavor bomb. Oh, I love this. I'm sorry we began without the two of you. But this dish was very tempting.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Excellent.
So I want to ask you, is food at home all about gazpacho and burrata?
No. The food at home is all Indian.
Yeah?
By me.
Cooked by you.
Chef gets to assist.
Chef gets to assist. So chef doesn't get to play executive chef at home.
Not at all. He's the sous chef.
No, I'm happy to assist and, you know, help her. Because if I go to the kitchen, then I need 10 assistants.
10 assistants. So we talk about Indians. So what's food at home like? So he's Bengali. You come from Delhi. So is it Bengali?
No, it's a mix of both.
Okay.
And a mix because we stay in South. So yes, it's a bit of the South as well.
Okay.
Goes by the day.
Okay.
So some days it's totally authentic Bengali.
All right.
Some days it is totally North Indian. And like today, we'll be having a mix. All the three.
Speaking of which, I can smell some aromas emanate
yes.
from the kitchen.
Yes.
You know, badi besabri se main intezar kar raha hun ki jab aap mujhe kitchen mein invite karoge. When you will invite me to the kitchen to take a look at what's cooking.
Let's go and let's right? finish.
So let's finish this burrata and gazpacho very quickly. The chef has put some effort and made this for us. So I think
yes.
we should finish this quickly and then head to the kitchen and see what's been cooked by the executive chef here. At Chef Abhijit Saha and Shruti Saha's residence.
Kripal, welcome to my humble kitchen.
Thank you. Well, going by what's on display here, it doesn't seem so humble.
So here,
wow.
We have bindi raita, achari potatoes, small potatoes.
Okay.
So this is a very Bengali baigan ka bharta. It has a very interesting flavor of mustard oil.
Oh, okay.
And uncooked mustard oil.
And then what do we have here?
This is malai koftas.
Malai koftas.
The curry is there. We're going to put it in the curry. I've marinated mackerels. Then we have white dal, which is called the urad dal.
Urad dal, of course.
This we have prawns.
So basically the food here is Indian, but draws from different
parts
yes.
of the country.
Different parts, right?
So we live in the South. South has to be an element of it.
Here we are going to do is, we are going to toss the arbi, which is a very popular dish in Delhi.
Delhi ka arbi meets the Kolkata ka baigan.
Yes.
So I think, you know, that's the beautiful thing about food in this country, right? So there are these connections.
Yes.
Right? Because I think there is perhaps a history that it all draws from.
Yes, it does. In India, the good part is that we like to utilize also different parts of the vegetable. So wastage was never an option. So you would use the leaf, find ways of using the leaf, the stem, even the root. So, you know, colocasia is one such example. So you use the leaf, you use the root, you use the stem.
Correct.
You use almost every part of the you know, vegetable.
So the root is the arbi.
Arbi, yes.
Of course. So we've just tasted the gazpacho and burrata, and we've got a bunch of other dishes here waiting to be tasted, right from the arbi to the jhinga, the prawn, the dal, the begun pora. And then of course we also have the mackerel that will be fried now, and the kofta that will soon transform itself into the malai kofta.
Yes.
I can't wait for this lunch to begin.
Let's begin.
Is lunch every day like this?
No, Kripal, because you are here, okay. We have made it for you. We generally would eat four dishes.
It will always be a vegetable, a dal, and a meat protein.
So what should we begin with? I don't know where to begin. So we've got some mackerel there. We have the arbi.
Yes.
The arbi which has been tossed, fried. This is the malai kofta. And that's the bhindi ka raita. Now this is a very unusual dish. I think this is something that I tasted at your place only earlier. And then you have the aloo, of course, and then the
begun pora.
Begun pora, burnt brinjal.
Yes, burnt and aubergine, yes.
Burnt aubergine, and then you have some vegetables here.
Mixed vegetables, yes.
Mixed vegetables, and of course, the prawns. And some salad. So, what should we begin with?
I think the idea would be to start with some maybe arbi and maybe some mackerel.
Ah, I was hoping you'd say that. So this is the arbi, the colocasia.
Arbi is very popular in North Indian households.
Aubergine.
It is served cold.
Oh, it's a cold dish.
Yes, yes. It is like an Indian version of baba ganoush.
So the Bengali version of
baba ganoush, yes.
You can certainly smell the mustard oil in that.
Yes.
So I think I have my begun pora, the fish, and also some arbi. I think we'll also get a bit of salad going just to balance all that out. And that also makes for a very pretty plate.
Bon appetit.
I think I'm going to begin with the arbi. There's something very comforting about eating arbi, right? And you also have some ajwain in that.
That's what gives the flavor to the vegetable.
The garam seeds. It's slimy and starchy, so if it's not cooked well, that's what it exhibits. But when you
cook, then it becomes slimy.
Mm.
Also, when you cook it with liquid.
Liquid, lot of water.
Ah, okay. So here that arbi is, because you've pan fried it, so it has that gentle crust.
Yeah.
Mmm. Certainly is a tasty arbi. I can't wait to try this begun pora. Mmm. You can definitely taste that mustard hit. That's the first thing that you taste in this dish.
So it's got onion, green chili, green coriander.
And the tomato. So the tomato also gives it a certain sourness, and then I think that onion gives it a nice crunch.
Crunch.
I think what's interesting about this is that there are layers of flavor and also layers of texture as well, right? So when you taste the soft creaminess of that eggplant and then that crunch of that onion, I bit into a chili there.
Mm.
And I can feel a slight trickle of heat at the back of my head.
Yes. That's the unique part about chili, you know. Mm. If you bite into it, it goes straight into your a certain part of your brain.
I think I'm going to taste the begun pora with some chapati
fulka.
I think this begun pora is a sort of dish that could be quite easily coaxed into the folds of a fulka. Mm. I love that. So the mustard oil is the wasabi of the East.
Yes.
Of East India.
East India, yeah. That mustard oil also is the cooking medium in Punjab.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. This is the aloo. And you cook the aloo with the skin here. So I'm going to go for that mackerel. So tell me, when it comes to Bengali food, is mackerel a part of that diet?
No.
Not really.
No. See, in Bengal, there is a very small area which is like the seafront, right? Mm. It's like the Sundarbans, the Digha and all of that. The southernmost part of Bengal. So, fish from the sea is not very often eaten in Bengal. It's the Ganges that run through Bengal, and there are multiple rivers, many other rivers. So that's what makes river fish more popular.
So the fish has actually just a gentle smear of the masala. There's not too much masala. So you're basically tasting more of the flavor of the fish. I like the flavor of the fish. The mackerel also is a fish that's quite assertive in its own flavors.
It is. It is.
So how often do you eat at home?
I eat at least one meal a day. I try my best
every
to
day.
Eat one meal a day, yes.
Today you've reached a certain stage where you probably are not spending as much time in the kitchen perhaps.
Right.
But at the beginning of your career or maybe somewhere around the middle, you probably must have been spending a lot of time in the kitchen. And so probably at that point you don't really come home too much for a meal and things like that.
No, you don't do that.
Okay.
If you are feeling like eating outside, you go to these places which are open till late at night and you know you go there to do that eating. I spent that part of my life in Delhi.
So what sort of food do you enjoy now?
See, for me, eating food with the knowledge about food, not just about cooking, but about where food comes from, how it is grown, how it is cultivated, and how it is, farmed. These things have definitely, you know, enlightened me more as a chef.
Okay.
And I think that in India, we need to now again focus back into clean food. That is food that is more organically grown, food that is without pesticides and without the artificial fertilizers. But I understand also the constraints of, you know, the productivity and feeding so many people. But as much as we can, we should try and eat food which is cooked with healthy ingredients.
So is that also a philosophy that you follow in your restaurants?
In my restaurants, yes. In the last few years, that's what I have been following.
Okay.
Because I became conscious that if I am serving something to my customers, it should not only be tasty or should not only look beautiful, it should also bring about nourishment and some sort of a wellness when you eat that. So that is what is the key that you need to focus on when you are now being a chef in today's era.
That's very true. So Shruti, what should I taste next? I've thoroughly enjoyed the fish, the arbi, the begun pora too. I think that was my find, yeah.
Try the malai kofta. It's a very different recipe. So the gravy is made from onion tomato. The creaminess is coming. I don't use cream, so I use milk as the thinning agent.
So what I find is that this kofta is quite light and then it's stuffed with something,
yes,
right?
Yes, it's stuffed with the badi ilaichi dana, the
black cardamom. So Ayoli is also parked herself conveniently next to the table and is threatening to bark and disrupt the shoot if not fed.
Yes.
I don't think we've ever had a dog bark at Gourmet on the Road. This is a first. This is an episode of many firsts. We have the chef's family, the chef's wife with us. That's the first. I have my wife with me. That's the first. And we have Ayoli here with us barking away. That's the first. This kofta is very light.
I think this is what I call as home cooking, Indian home cooking. When it, by the time it reaches some commercial restaurants,
Is there methi in this?
Yes, there is fenugreek in the curry.
Right, the fenugreek seeds. I can taste the softness of the paneer and then the flavor of that methi, the kasuri methi. So kasuri methi again is a very north.
Yes.
Right?
So I think the kasuri methi, it has come because of the methi is a seasonal vegetable. So they dry it and store it.
And you know, the seeds are bitter from methi. That is also one of the spices that we use in India very commonly.
South, we curry every sambar and all, we season it with the mustard, methi seeds, and dry chilies, curry powder,
The bhindi rather. So here the bhindi are first sauteed, are first fried.
Fried, actually. Mixed it with the curds.
It certainly has all its, most of its crispiness intact.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
So what it also does is that because you fry it, it also brings some of that oil into that raita.
Two of Shruti's speciality raitas are bhindi and aubergine.
I think that's probably just to please the Bengali. You do the begun in some form or the other.
And then you are happy.
The Bengali is happy, right? What's your favorite dish that Shruti makes?
I think there are a lot of dishes she cooks very well. There was a time when I used to eat a lot of meat as well. Nowadays, I don't eat that.
So what do you eat these days?
I mostly focus on vegetables.
Okay.
Then I'm not a vegan.
Okay.
Because I eat still dairy.
Okay.
And I eat some fish and seafood once in a while.
So what about when you're developing menus in your restaurants?
I do taste them. Okay. I do taste anything that I have to cook for my guests.
Hmm.
That doesn't mean that I eat it in my home or as my meal. I give up eating meats, but I think that she cooks different kinds of lamb and chicken curries very well. She also cooks chicken korma very well.
Okay.
Then there is, of course, the crab curry, which is superb. She makes a superb coastal style crab curry with coconut milk and all of that.
When are you making that next?
The next gourmet on the...
Well, I don't have to come with a camera for that. I'll come with a camera if I have to eat that crab curry, but...
Yeah. Also, okay. She has recently picked up, because of the kids, they demand variety. So she's learned how to make appam with stew.
So is there ever a time where you feel like eating a particular dish that he cooks?
I think the risotto.
Yeah.
Any day. Hands down. I think there's no one better who can make a better risotto than Abhijit.
Yeah.
Whether it's a seafood or a mushroom, I just had it day for yesterday. It is so satisfying.
In the restaurant or at
home? At home.
At home.
At home.
So when you want to eat a good mushroom risotto, you order the chef and tell him that I want to eat that.
Yes.
Well, that's the advantage of having a chef at home. This is a very gentle dal. There's barely any spicing.
Mm-hmm.
No, so that's ginger, onions, tomato.
No garlic.
No garlic. A little heat.
So I think I'm going to taste the rice and the prawn curry.
Yeah.
I'm going to get a bit of the rice first.
Yeah.
Lovely. Maybe some of the gravy. Thank you.
Welcome.
From the face of it, it looks somewhere close to a kolambu.
Yes.
With the, you know, the mustard.
Yes, and the curry leaves.
That curry certainly has all the flavor of the prawn.
It is. And it's a little more spicier than the other dishes that you might have had.
I think it's also the way this curry has been prepared.
So the prawns are simmered in the curry.
Yeah.
That prawn curry is delicious. So this is spicy, but then it also has that tomato.
Yeah.
That kind of balances the spice. The red chili spices.
Yeah.
There's a certain creaminess to it, a certain thickness to it.
That's because of the coconut milk.
Oh, okay. The masala is basically a tomato and onion.
Onion. Yeah.
And then the coconut milk just added.
Just adds to the texture.
And then you use some chili in this.
Yes.
What do you use? A bhargi chili?
Bhargi chili.
Mm. Food on the table, certainly. Has been a confluence of different flavors of India. From the begun pora that comes from the east to the kolambu style shrimp curry that comes from the south, and not to forget the arbi, the humble arbi that's so predominant in the north. I've certainly enjoyed my meal at your house. Thank you very much for having us over.
We're not done yet, Kripal, because you know there's something which is missing yet.
Okay.
It's the dessert.
The dessert, of course.
Yes. So Shruti has prepared a dessert.
Okay.
And I'm going to prepare one in front of you from the Caperberry cookbook.
Fantastic. Jaise bolte hain, sone pe suhaga.
So now we're going to make the churros modern.
Okay.
This is inspired by churros, but it's slightly different. We made the churros first. We baked it instead of frying it.
Okay.
And then we made it into a powder.
So is the recipe for this also there in the cookbook?
It is there. It's okay. A part of the book.
And what is this seductive looking chocolate?
So this is the real part of the churros, which is the chocolate. Okay. And it's got cinnamon powder as the spice to spice it up a little bit. Then we have some marine for decoration and also some twill.
So typically when it comes to churros, the churros and chocolate is a classic combination.
Yes.
So how? What inspired you to...
So in Caperberry, we do some creative cooking.
Okay.
We want to surprise our customers a little bit.
Okay.
You know, people would have eaten churros in different restaurants, but this is a dish which you only get in Caperberry.
All right.
So it's about the creative aspect of a chef and where you take some liberties in doing things a little differently, where you also enjoy when your customers say, oh my God, we are expecting churros, which looks like fingers.
That's right.
But you know, what do we get here? And then when you eat the whole dish, it tastes exactly like the churros.
You basically are deconstructing it.
Yes.
But when you taste it on your palate, it all comes together.
All comes together. Yes, that's
super.
Right.
So let's watch the coming together of the churros modern.
That's right. So I have the white chocolate ganache, the baked churros powder.
Let's cover the chocolate ganache now.
Yes. We will decorate this. We have the marine here. some edible flowers, and we will sprinkle some cinnamon powder.
Oh, that's cinnamon powder, okay.
Yeah. And now we pour the chocolate.
We're ready to taste this?
Yeah, sure.
It looks so pretty. That chocolate is just holding everything together.
Yeah.
It's been poured just a few seconds ago. This takes churros to a whole new form.
I'm glad.
So these are baked churros, so you...
Yeah.
So I guess it's healthier.
It is.
So you're definitely tasting the flavor of the churro, but more in a powdered...
Yeah.
And that cinnamon, you can definitely taste the cinnamon there as well.
Yes, yes.
Chocolate and cinnamon, great combination. I just want to taste it with some of that white chocolate ganache too. I mean, what I find is that the recipes here are definitely the sort, like you said, will make people take notice of the dishes.
Yes.
So if you are, let's say, entertaining and you put this out for dessert,
yeah,
people will go back talking about this dessert.
Yep.
It does involve a bit of effort.
So while I say that the dishes are simple, but it doesn't mean that they are the easiest to make. So you need to put in an effort. But the results are definitely rewarding.
So this is certainly a dish that makes an impression. Like many of the dishes that I have seen in the Caperberry cookbook and also at Caperberry.
Kripal, that's for you.
Wow.
So this is a kheer.
Okay.
Which is made with nolon gur.
Nolon gur.
The gur comes from Bengal.
So this is the gur from the date palm. Is it the nutun gur? Is it the nolon gur?
It is both.
Okay.
It is both. Nutun means new.
Nutun means new. And nolon?
Means new. It's one of my favorite desserts because of the flavor that the nolon gur gives to this dessert or any other dessert that you prepare with it.
So this is of course made with the rice.
Yes.
So do you use a Govindabhog or is it the local?
Govindabhog.
Oh, it's a Govindabhog rice.
Yes,
it is as delicious as the rest of the dishes that we've tasted. Thank you so much for inviting us home, for sharing all that wonderful food with us, and also for allowing us and the viewers a glimpse into your home. Thank you very much. And if you want to take a closer look at the Caperberry cookbook, and I suggest you must, especially if you're a food lover and love to cook up interesting dishes for your family and friends, do look at the Caperberry cookbook. It's available on Amazon and Flipkart. I'm going to place links in the video description below. Thank you once again. And until the next episode of Gourmet on the Road, stay safe and
happy eating.
Happy eating. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the home page. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!